Good evening, everyone. I'm so glad you're here for Christmas Eve, for anyone who's online, and for those of you who are present. Welcome to the celebration of the birth of the Son of God, the living Son of God, Jesus Christ. And so let us enjoy a time of a prelude, and then we'll have the lighting of the candles.
The Christmas season culminates by again lighting the candles of hope, peace, joy, and love. Tonight, the Christ candle is also lit to commemorate the birth of Jesus, God incarnate, the living Son of God Most High, born in Bethlehem. As written in Micah 5:2, "But you, Bethlehem Ephrathah, though you are small among the clans of Judah, out of you will come for me one who will be ruler over Israel, whose origins are from old, from ancient times."
Tonight, as we remember that Christ came as our Savior, our prayer of confession is simply the Lord's Prayer. Let us remain seated and speak that together in unison. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Let us stand again, together as we say responsively our assurance of forgiveness. Hear the good news. Who is in the position to condemn? Only Christ, and Christ died for us. Christ rose for us. Christ reigns in power for us. Christ prays for us. Anyone who is in Christ is a new creation. The old life has gone, a new life has begun. Know that you are forgiven and be at peace. Amen. Prepare to hear God's word on the birth of Jesus Christ. Let us call out and ask for the word to be heard in unison. Scripture cannot be set aside. What does Scripture say? Lord, we know what Scripture says this night. Every time at Christmas Eve, we hear this account. But we ask, Lord, for you to quicken our hearts to hear it again, to hear it anew, and to renew us for the word that you have for us tonight. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. You may be seated. We're opening our scripture from the Pew Bibles, if you'd like to tend to doing that, on page 1459. We're in the second chapter of Luke. This is the only infant narrative, the newborn infant narrative. It only appears here. We've been looking at the first chapters of every gospel, but here we are in the second chapter. We'll be reading slowly through this passage, verses at a time, and interspersed between the verses, there will be an appropriate, responsive Christmas carol, a Christmas hymn to sing. They will be pertinent as to the reading. And so hear the first words from verses 1 through 4 in second chapter of Luke. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria. And everyone went to their own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Bethlehem. To Bethlehem. We'll be singing the song, O Little Town of Bethlehem, but before we do, I want to give you what the takeaway is tonight. Jesus is in the house. What a great message to hear. Jesus is in the house. What does that have to do with Bethlehem? The word Bethlehem, the town's name, is two words. In the Hebrew, bet or bayit, which means house. And lahem, or lechem, as it should be said in the Hebrew, that means bread. Jesus was born, as the prophets said in Micah, read by Linda, in the house of bread. Jesus is in the house. Please remain seated and turn to 250, O Little Town of Bethlehem. Let us sing together.
Yeah.
continue our reading in Luke 2. Hear the full reading of verse 4, moving through verse 5. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. Jesus is in the house. He's in the house of bread in Bethlehem. But Jesus is also in the house of David. For both Mary and Joseph are from the house of David. And the prophets had said, not only would the Messiah come from the town of Bethlehem, the house of bread, but also from the house of David. Jesus is in the house. Let us respond as we sing hymn number 286, Once in Royal David's City. Reading, we read again verse 5 and also verse 6. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born. So we might ask in song, what child is this? Hymn number 281. Let us sing.
What child is this?
finish with the last two verses of this particular passage, verses 6 through 7. While they that were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger because there was no guest room available for them. Let us respond as we sing together hymn number 262, Away in a Manger. Jesus is in the house. As the prophet said, he's in the house of bread, the house that is called Bethlehem. Jesus is in the house. He is born into the house of David. And yet, as we hear the story today, we hear that there was no guest room available for them. And we might have in our mind a picture that Jesus wasn't in the house at all, that he was in a cave, that he was out of a house in a place separate from where people would live. When we studied, though, at Sunday school, we learned a different rendition, that most people who are archaeologists and historians and theologians would know. So I want to paint a picture for you that might be different than the one that you picture. Jesus is in the house. He was in the house, even when he was laid in the manger, even when he was in a stable. You see, the Hebrew houses had different parts to them. The main floor was the family quarter, where the family lived. And above that, on the second floor, was the guest room or multiple guest rooms. Underneath the family quarter, but still in the family quarter, was the stable, where the family would keep their animals, where they would get their eggs from their chickens, where they would get their milk from their cows, whatever animals were underneath the family quarter of the house. So even though there was no guest room in the upper story, Jesus was in the house. This might be a different picture for you than what you've had before. So there was no guest room available for them. Why? Because it tells us in this story that everyone went to their own town to register. Where were Mary and Joseph from? They were from the town of Nazareth. When I went to Israel, I learned something I did not know. We're never too old to learn. We're all learning new things. Nazareth means the root, from where something would spring. Nazareth is the root. What had happened was, a long time before Nazareth was formed, there was a famine in Bethlehem. That wasn't uncommon. It had happened to Naomi and her family in the book of Ruth, and the people had left Bethlehem and gone elsewhere. The same had happened, and all the people moved to find a new place to live. They established a town called Nazareth. So not only did Joseph and Mary go from Nazareth to Bethlehem, so did all the other people go to their own town to register. That's why there was no room for them in the guest rooms, because everyone else was there. And because Mary was carrying Jesus, she moved at a slower pace. Wouldn't that be so? Maybe not in a car, but certainly when a woman is expecting a baby, if she'd have to ride a donkey, you better move a little slower to protect her. And they did. But by the time they came from Nazareth to Bethlehem, all the guest rooms were taken. And even in the main part of the house where the family lived, so many people had come to the town that perhaps the family was sharing their sleeping space too. So there was no space in the guest rooms at the second floor. There was no space on the main floor in the family rooms. The only space was underneath the family quarters. And what we might call the garage. We don't keep animals in our garage, but does anybody have a car with horsepower? It's the same premises, right? We all have cars with horsepower. It's interesting. Just a couple months ago, in the neighborhood where I live, just a mile, less than a mile down the road, a new opening came so that I can drive here by driving down Pataskala Ridge, if you know where that street is. If you drive down that street to the very end of the street, I saw something interesting for this Christmas season. That family, I don't know if they're listening, that family has their garage door open, and across their garage door is a tapestry of the nativity scene. Right across the opening of their stable, I mean their garage. Jesus was in the house. How do we know that he was not away from Bethlehem, that he was not in a cave removed? Because if we would read on a little further, we would hear that the shepherds, to go visit the Christ child, they go to Bethlehem. You can read on and see that yourself, to visit the child. Bethlehem's a town. They went into the house because Jesus was in the house. They visited him, and they proclaimed the good news of Christ's arrival as faithful followers of Christ. They were so glad for the news that Jesus was in the house. So what might be our question today? What is this going to mean to us? I'd like you to think about your houses. Think about, what if the Holy Family would come to visit you? Mary expecting a baby, or maybe Jesus when she's full grown. Where would they be in your house? I would guess, since you don't run an inn, you'd probably find space for them in a guest room, though there was none in Bethlehem. You would put them safely in a guest room, and because they're special people, you might even make sure that your formal living room is opened up and your formal dining room, and treat them as guests. But is that really what God wants of us? We are part of God's family, and he should be part of our families too. He wants to be a part of the family quarters at our house. He wants to be eat in the kitchen and be in the family room. He doesn't want to be separate. He wants to be fully engaged in our families and in our homes. Who here would make them sleep in the garage? Anyone? I doubt it. But if he's part of the family, would he be allowed to go into the garage? Or into the attic? Or into the basement? Or into the cupboards? Would he be permitted to see every space in our houses? You know, when you were getting ready for Christmas and you knew company was coming and all the things that you didn't want them to see and you stuffed into places, would Jesus have access to everything? Would you be embarrassed what he might find there? He's part of the family. Guess what? He already knows what we stash in those places. And he wants to have full access. Jesus is in the house, and he already knows what's in it. And the house is not just a building. We are the houses of God. Jesus has brought into us the Holy Spirit. We are his house. Our heart is his home. Let me ask, is there any place in our lives, in our hearts, in our minds? You know, he knows our every thought. He knows everything that we do. I'm sure many of you had cleaned your house to get ready for Christmas. But what about after Christmas? As a gift to Jesus, shall we do a full house cleaning to make sure that every part of our houses, not the building where we live, but where he lives in us, so that Jesus can live fully and completely as part of our family and we part of his. Be glad Jesus is in the house. Thanks be to God. So as faithful followers, now let us stand and sing hymn number 249, O Come All Ye Faithful. Let us adore him as we say in unison together our affirmation of faith from the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Jesus is in the house, and soon the house will be filled with light. I want to make sure, does everyone have a candle? If anyone does not have a candle, raise your hand, and I'm going to ask Elise to look around to see if anybody on your side doesn't have a candle, and bring them up that are sitting out here for candles. Does anyone on this side need a candle? No, we're all good. This is wonderful. So we're going to go ahead and take the light from the Christ candle and pass it through the congregation. We'll play Silent Night once through to give us all time to have our candles lit. Linda, you'll be ready with getting the lights ready for us, correct? Number 22.
253.
Thank you. 253. If we can turn off the lights down lower.
Thank you.
He's in this house. He's in your house. He's in our house. Jesus is in the house. When you go home from there, carry his light into your house and into the world. Together we say our blessing and charge to walk in the light of God. Making Jesus known is first at first. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Merry Christmas.